The Torah portion of Behar, Behar meaning on the mountain, begins with a discussion of the sabbatical year. Now, we're all familiar with the general idea of the Sabbath, the Shabbos, where we have a day of introspection, a day withdrawing from the world, a day to spend with our families, a day to find inner peace. But what is a sabbatical year? How are you supposed to spend the whole year in introspection, finding inner peace? That seems to be impossible. And of course, the restrictions in Jewish law and the sabbatical year is not as stringent as on the Sabbath. But the only thing that people are not allowed to do is harvest, basically. But there is this idea of having a Sabbath the whole year. How do you do that? So let's just focus in what a general Sabbath is. One day out of seven, which is, of course, Judaism's gift to the world, the seven-day week. One day out of seven, we withdraw. So why only one? What about never? Some people I know work 7 days a week. They never take a rest. And some people just never work. They retire when they're 20 years old and they just sit around doing nothing. What is the correct balance between work and peaceful introspection? So the Torah says it's one out of seven. You need to take one period out of seven just to reflect, to think, and to find your inner self. Because there's no perfect way of staying on the fence. You can't possibly integrate into the world all the time. You'll get dragged into it. And you can't possibly be in transcendent joy, mystical bliss all the time because you'll be useless to mankind. You have to find a peaceful harmony between the two. And that is why Hasidic thought says our heart beats. If you ever had your blood pressure taken, you'll notice there's two numbers. That's not one. There's the diastolic pressure and the systolic pressure. Systolic pressure is when your heart is contracting, and diastolic pressure is when your heart is relaxing, because there's always a beat in life. So long as you're alive, you have to, of course, the relaxation of the heart is immersed in the world. You have to withdraw back into yourself. There always has to be a cycle, because we can never get it right. The sabbatical year is the greatest challenge of all. For an entire year, to somehow get that balance right, to somehow manage to be in the world without becoming worldly, to somehow seek success without it taking over our lives. That is the challenge of the sabbatical year, and it's really a very great one. In a sense, it's the erasure of the duality between matter and spirit, which of course plagues us. Most of us in the secular world are always seeking material success, and eventually it just swallows us up. And then you have religious people who are constantly seeking spiritual enlightenment, and they end up messed up because they're not integrated into the world enough. Striking that balance is very hard, and that's really what the Torah is teaching us and empowering us to do with the idea of the sabbatical year. Now, if you think this isn't very significant, it's just a nice idea to say by your Shabbos table, I was fascinated to discover recently that in his lengthy correspondence with President Reagan, the Lubavitcher Rebbe actually mentioned once the idea of the sabbatical year. It was in 1987, which was a sabbatical year, and in a postscript to a letter to Reagan, the Rebbe wrote as follows. This is a letter dated September 6, 1987. May I add, Mr. President, the current year in the Jewish calendar, 5747, is a sabbatical year. One of the underlying purposes of this unique institution, which calls for rest from certain agricultural activities, is that it provides additional time, which should be spent on more intensive study, and on activities dedicated to morally uplifting pursuits. This lesson has special significance in this day and age, when largely, as a result of what you rightly call incomplete education, moral and ethical standards have not kept pace with technological advancement. So interestingly, this is a message which is more relevant for our day and age than ever, the idea of the Sabbath, the idea of a year-long Sabbath. So think about it in your own life. Do you have enough Sabbath? Do you celebrate the weekly Sabbath? Do you have a daily Sabbath where you just withdraw and reflect on your purpose, how centered you are, how stoked your inner flame is? Do you do that enough? Most of us don't. So this week's Torah portion is an ideal time to think about that. Now, another insight about this week's portion, which I love, is the idea of the mountain. Now, Mount Sinai, of course, was the location where the Torah was given, the Sinaitic Revelation, and it was the Medrash, the rabbinic sages taught, that Sinai was chosen because it is the smallest of all mountains. Which is a bit odd, because, I mean, a mountain is, of course, a huge, great thing, sticking out of the ground. And even a small mountain is mountainous. So if God was looking for a symbol. A symbol in nature of humility. How about a valley? How about a lowly piece of rock? How about the Torah could have been given out of a hole in the ground? Why do we have to have it given on a small mountain? So the message here is again a complex tension in our personalities. A different type of tension I mentioned before, but a tension nonetheless. And that is the tension between the desire to be self-assertive, which is the idea of a mountain, this great honking great piece of rock, shoves itself in your face. And then we have the idea of being more humble, self-effacing, or I like to call it integrative. When we're humble, we realize we're just one little piece of humanity. In fact, humanity is just one little piece of this ecosphere that we live in. And we all, in a sense, have equal rights to live here. No thing is really incomparably superior to another. We achieve perfection by realizing how we integrate and interconnect with the rest of the universe, and not by the desire to dominate it. And that's the idea of small mountain. It's the perfect and harmonious equilibrium between self-assertiveness and the consciousness of the need to integrate into the rest of the world. Self-assertive thinking would be typified by rationality, critical thought, and the desire to refute others' arguments by strict linear thought, that one argument follows the next, which follows the next. Whereas integrative thought would be typified by intuitive wisdom, by non-linear wisdom, by seeing how ideas connect together rather than the superiority of one idea over the other. And then we have, of course, in values, self-assertive values are dominance, the desire to take over the world, to rule, dominion, whereas integrative values are represented more by a sense of awe and connectedness, a sense of that quantity matters more than quality, a sense that we are really just one little speck of dust in the rest of the universe, and we belong here by realizing the context of our place in that ecosphere. That's small mountain. Think about it. It's very powerful. Brief Kabbalistic insight. In addition to the sabbatical year, we also have the idea in this week's Torah portion of the Jubilee year, which is every 50 years, when loans are released and other things happen. I won't focus on the details of the law, but just on the Kabbalistic insight. The sabbatical year corresponds to Malchut, the Sephira, the divine energy of Malchut, which is loyalty. Whereas the Jubilee year corresponds to Binah, which means intuitive wisdom. Now, which is greater? When you are loyal to God, or you are intuitive with God? So, of course, the Jubilee year following a number of sabbatical years suggests that the Jubilee year is superior. But isn't loyalty the primary value in Judaism? Don't we say Na'aseh v'nishma? Don't we say that you need to obey God and only then start listening to try and understand why we need to follow Him? That's true at the beginning. But you see, so long as you have to be loyal and you're coercing your inner demons to do the right thing, there's a disjoint in your personality. There's a schism within you. And you're not at peace. And you're actually in risk of falling to pieces because you're constantly forcing yourself to do something that you don't want to do. When your own intuition is honed to the point which you want to do the Torah, you want to be a righteous person, you want to have integrative thought, it makes sense to you, it resonates with you, then you don't have to fight with the inner demons anymore because you've trained the ego to do what God wants. You've trained that ego to be part of the larger sphere of mankind and not to want to dominate everyone else because you feel so low and pitiful. So really, Binah, the Jubilee year, the symbol of the Jubilee year, is much more powerful. Spiritual message for the week is the mountain. Go up on the mountain. Be proud of your Judaism in the public arena. Reach high. Stand magnanimously and be a huge example to others. Thanks very much for listening, and join us again next week for Torah in 10.